Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for standing by and welcome to the UP Fintech Holding Limited Fourth Quarter 2019 Earnings Conference Call. At this time, all participants are in a listen-only mode. There will be a presentation followed by a question-answer session. I must advise you that this conference is being recorded today, Wednesday the 25th, 2020. I would now like to hand the conference over to your first speaker today, Mr. Clark Sosie. Thank you. Please go ahead.
Thank you, Rachel. Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us for the call today. UP Fintech Holding Limited's fourth quarter 2019 earnings release was distributed earlier today and is available on our IR website at ir.itiger.com as well as Globe Newswire Services. On the call today from UP Fintech are Mr. Wu Tianhua, Chairman and Chief Executive Officer, Mr. John Zhang, Chief Financial Officer, Mr. Huang Lei, CEO of U.S. Tiger Securities, and Mr. Kenny Zhao, our Financial Controller. Mr. Wu will give an overview of our business operations and discuss corporate highlights. Mr. Zhang will then discuss our financial results. They will both be available to answer your questions during the Q&A session that follows their remarks. Now, let me cover the safe harbor. Today's discussion will contain forward-looking statements. These forward-looking statements involve inherent risks and uncertainties that may cause actual results to differ materially from our current expectations. Potential risks and uncertainties include, but are not limited to, those outlined in our public filings with the SEC. Any forward-looking statements that we make on this call are based on assumptions as of today, but we do not take any obligation to update these statements, except as required under applicable law. It is now my pleasure to introduce our Chairman and Chief Executive Officer, Mr. Wu. Mr. Wu will make remarks in Chinese, which will be followed by an English translation. Mr. Wu, please go ahead with your remarks.
大家好，非常感谢各位来参加老虎证券2019年第四季度财报发布会。 在跟大家分享2019年第四季度业务之前， 我想跟大家简单介绍一下关于新冠肺炎的情况。鉴于我们的业务主要是在线线上进行， 新冠病毒对公司的整体业务没有实质性的影响， 公司一贯将员工的健康和安全放在首位， 因此针对此次疫情， 公司采取了非常严格的预防和保障措施， 全球各地的子公司以及办公室 目前已经根据当地的政策采取分批次办公或者在家办公的方式继续为我们的客户服务。那接下来我来介绍一下公司2019年第四季度运营的情况。老虎在第四季度取得了非常大的进展，总收入达到1997万美金，再创历史新高，比去年同期大幅增长了110%，是2019年同比增速最快的季度。
收入构成持续优化，利息相关收入已经超过佣金，占到总收入的36%。TIGR业务收入也占到总收入的26%，而去年同期收入的74%来自于佣金。四季度我们也首次实现了30万美金的非美国通用准则下的经营利润，相比去年同期280万美金和今年三季度130万美金的经营性亏损，
有明显改善，老虎的经营效率和盈利质量正在逐步提升。Good
evening, everyone, and thank you very much for attending the Tiger Brokers 2019 fourth quarter and full year earnings conference call. Before I elaborate on our business results, I would like to make a brief comment on the virus pandemic. Since we operate an online platform, there has not been a substantial impact on our business. However, the health and safety of our employees is paramount, and our firm has taken extra precautions. At our global offices, employees are working in shifts or from home. I will now continue with my prepared remarks. In the fourth quarter, TIGR delivered impressive financial results. Total revenue was $20 million, a new all-time high, and nearly 110% increase over the same period last year. In the fourth quarter of 2019, we achieved the fastest year-over-year revenue growth of any quarter last year. In addition, I would like to highlight that we continue to optimize our revenue mix. Interest-related income, which is interest income plus financing service fees, exceeded commission income and accounted for 38% of total revenue. 2B revenue, which includes our corporate services like IPO distribution and ESOP administration services, increased to 26% of total revenue. This is compared to 2018, when 74% of our income was derived from commissions. In the fourth quarter, we reported our first ever non-GAAP operating income of US$0.3 million, a significant improvement from a non-GAAP operating loss of US$2.8 million in the same period of 2018, and a $1.3 million loss in the third quarter of 2019, demonstrating the improvement in TIGR's operating efficiency and earnings quality.
我们也欣慰地发现, 随着老虎提供更多差异化的产品和服务, 越来越多的用户选择相信老虎, 四季度新增入金约 1.13万人, 相比前三季度平均单季新增入金数 大幅增长了 86%， 客户总资产规模也达到历史新高的 51亿美金， 比去年同期大幅增长了 114%， 相比今年三季度也增长了 13亿美金。
We are also pleased to report that our innovative platform and differentiated services continue to drive ever more investors to choose TIGR to manage their assets. In the fourth quarter, we added approximately 11,300 new accounts with deposits, an increase of 86% from the same quarter in 2018. In addition, total client assets increased to $5.1 billion, a nearly 114% increase from the same period in 2018, and an increase of $1.3 billion from the third quarter of 2019.
全年来看 2019年的财务表现也大幅优于2018年， 总收入 5866万美金， 同比增长了 75%， 同时 2019年第三季度和第四季度也连续实现了两个季度 non-GAAP盈利。
In aggregate, our 2019 financial results evidenced a solid improvement over 2018. Total revenues in 2019 were $58.7 million, a 75% increase over 2018. We also achieved consecutive non-GAAP profit for the third and fourth quarter of 2019.
2019年是老虎历史上非常重要的一年。 3月登陆纳斯达克成为上市公司， 用透明坦诚的心态迎接市场的考验。 2019年充满挑战， 但我们也收获颇丰。
2019 was a monumental year in the history of our company. In March, we successfully listed on the NASDAQ and embarked on a new journey in our company's history. 2019 was full of challenges, but we remained focused and continued to emphasize transparency and made positive progress on our business. I would now like to highlight four key components of our corporate strategy that we successfully implemented over the last year.
首先我们从战略上明确了要从三方清算过渡到自我清算。自我清算不仅能降低成本，也能带来更多利益收入，降低佣金波动对收入的影响。因此我们在7月份并购了Masco，取得了美国清算牌照。按照目前的系统开发进度，我们预计在2020年第二季度末可以逐步开展美股正股的自我清算。
First and foremost, we are following our strategy of shifting from relying on clearing counterparties to developing our self-clearing capabilities. Self-clearing will not only reduce our expenses and drive increased interest income, it will also limit the impact to revenue from commission volatility. This was our reason for acquiring Marsco in July. System integration is on track. We expect to gradually self-clear U.S. cash equities for the end of the second quarter of 2020.
第二点，然后的国际化发展在2019年提速，除了已经有的新西兰办公室，美国和新加坡办公室已经开始展业。我坚信海外布局能在2020年给老虎带来更多优质的用户，开发更多的业务机会。
Second, our strategy to increase our international reach progressed nicely in 2019. Besides our New Zealand office, we now have a presence in the United States and Singapore. We are confident that our international expansion will increase our customer base.And give us access to more business development opportunities.
第三，老虎的投行和 ESOP 业务发展迅速。2019年参与了18宗 IPO 发行，成交了其中的12宗，在中概股 IPO 成交数量上排名第一，远超其他中资券商。投行业务不仅产生收入，也提升了我们的品牌，增强了用户粘性等。ESOP 业务2019年发展迅速。一年时间从零到一，对入金人数的提升已经在第四季度开始体现。第四季度的新增入金中有20%来自于 ESOP 客户。
Third, our ESOP business and IPO underwriting delivered strong growth in 2019. In 2019, we participated in 18 U.S. IPOs, in 12 of which we served as underwriter. We were the number one.IPO underwriter in terms of deal number for Chinese issuers in 2019 by a wide margin. And the scale of our IPO business greatly exceeded that of any other Chinese broker. Besides the contribution to our revenues, we view the development of our investment banking services as beneficial to our reputation and accretive to user stickiness. Our ESOP business also grew rapidly in 2019.We developed a large client base in just 1 year's time, and it started to yield results. I am pleased to report that in the fourth quarter, over 20% of newly funded accounts came from our ESOP customers.
第四，我们也加大了对资管的投入。老虎主动管理的闲钱管家从上线到现在，给用户带来了不错的收益。我们也刚上线了基金超市。有超过3种基金供用户选择，资管业务和经纪业务相辅相成，能增强用户粘性，长期来看能实现佣金、利息、管理费等收入的多元化，来获得更多的用户的 time value。
In addition, we are investing in our asset management business. TIGR's actively managed cash plus product.Has delivered good investment returns for our users since launch. We also recently launched our Fund Mall, where users may choose from over 30 investment funds. We view brokerage and asset management as complementary, as our growing range of services increases user stickiness. Over the long term, this strategy will comprehensively develop commissions, interest income, and asset management fees.Diversifying our revenue and increasing customer lifetime value.
最后，经公司董事会同意，我们决定实施一项股票回购计划，在未来的12月回购最多不超过2000万美金的公司股票。总的来说，我们将继续实行上述战略计划，继续发展我们公司的业务。
Finally, after discussion and agreement by the board of directors.We have decided to implement a share buyback program. Over the next 12 months, we will allocate a maximum of U.S. $20 million to ADS buybacks. In conclusion, we look forward to continuing to implement the 4 aforementioned points of our corporate strategy and growing our business.
现在请 CFO John 跟各位汇报一下财务细节。
I would now like to invite our CFO,John Zhang, to discuss our key financial results.
Thanks, Tianhua. Thanks, Clark. Hello, everyone. Overall, a very strong fourth quarter for TIGR. Total revenue was $20 million USD, grew more than 100% year over year and 30% quarter over quarter. Commission income was $7.3 million, increased 4% from last year and 17% from previous quarter. Cash equity blended commission was 8 bps this quarter versus 5 bps same quarter last year. Financing service fee increased 18% year over year to $2 million this quarter. Interest income grew more than 100 times year over year to $5.5 million this quarter as we have more consolidated account customers versus last year. The growth for financing service fee and interest income also both benefited from increased margin and securities lending activity this quarter. Other revenue primarily consists revenue from corporate services such as IPO underwriting, grew close to 700% year over year to $5.1 million. We were very active in IPO underwriting last year. In terms of deal counts, far exceeded any of our competitors. It's also an effective customer acquisition tool to develop retail and institutional business. Comparing revenue composition with fourth quarter last year, we are happy to see revenue mix is getting more healthy. Interest-related income this quarter accounted for 38% of total revenue. Corporate services accounted for 26%, while in the fourth quarter last year, commission accounted for 74% of the total revenue. Interest expense grew to $1.5 million this quarter due to more consolidated account customers. After interest expense, net revenue was $18.5 million, a 94% increase from same quarter last year. Now switching to expense. Clearing expense increased from $0.1 million in the fourth quarter last year to $0.9 million this quarter, in line with our growth of consolidated accounts. Salary expense increased 61% to $10.6 million, primarily due to a 49% headcount increase year over year. In 2020, we will keep adding key positions, but our headcount growth rate will moderate. Occupancy expense increased 72% to $1.1 million as we opened the offices in New York and Singapore. Communication and market data expense also grew 100% year over year to $1.9 million as more users are using our services. Marketing expense decreased 25% year over year to $1.7 million this quarter as we optimized our marketing strategies, which led to higher efficiency. General and administrative expense increased 14% to $2.8 million, primarily due to business expansion and professional services. Total expense for fourth quarter was $19.1 million, an increase of 46% year over year. Operating loss was $0.7 million this quarter, an improvement of 80% year over year. Non-GAAP operating income turned positive for the first time at $0.3 million, compared to a non-GAAP operating loss of $2.8 million last year. Net loss for UpFintech was $0.6 million in the fourth quarter of 2019, compared to a net loss of $2 million in the fourth quarter of 2018. Our net loss of $0.6 million this quarter was primarily due to a $1.9 million foreign currency exchange loss we let it out as other expenses. Let me elaborate a little bit more on this FX loss. As of now, we book majority of our revenue and client assets in New Zealand entity. Under New Zealand regulation, financial reporting needs to be in local currency, which is New Zealand dollar, while most of our revenue and asset inflows are settled in USD or Hong Kong dollar on a daily basis. So when our New Zealand entity prepares local financial reporting on a monthly or quarterly basis, there will be difference due to different exchange rate when revenue and related asset are booked and when reporting is done. So in the fourth quarter, New Zealand dollar has been gradually raising against the U.S. dollar and Hong Kong dollar. So we booked this difference as a FX loss. There was no FX transaction took place and low cash loss. It's just a pure accounting treatment to reconcile the difference between our consolidated book and local book. And our non-GAAP net income was $0.3 million this quarter as compared to a U.S. $1.2 million non-GAAP net loss in the fourth quarter of 2018. So to summarize, we are satisfied with our progress in the fourth quarter. Revenue mix is more balanced. New accounts with deposits showed accelerated growth quarter over quarter and year over year. And the total client asset also grew at a fast pace. We are confident as long as we execute the strategies laid out in Tianhua's earlier remarks, we can deliver good growth for 2020. This concludes our prepared remarks. Now we can open for questions.
Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. If you wish to ask a question, please press star 1 on your telephone and wait for a name to be announced. If you wish to cancel your request, please press the pound or hash key. Once again, if you wish to ask a question, you may press star 1 on your telephone keypad. Your first question comes from the line of Levy Liu from HSBC. Please ask your question.
Oh, thanks, management. I have three questions today. First one is that why is our trading volume down Q-on-Q, but commission income up Q-on-Q? And second question is about the liquidity and risk management. Could management share with us these liquidity situations and also the margin calls situations recently, especially during this month. And a third question is about the competitive advantage. So what's the competition strategy for us? As we have seen that a lot of similar internet brokers for overseas securities trading recently have sprung up in China and also invested by some internet companies. Quite a lot of apps are joining this competition. So what do you think is our competitive advantage compared to all these competitors? Thank you.
Thanks, Libby. I will answer your question number 1 and number 2. Then Tianhua will answer your question number 3. Okay. So let me answer your second question first. What's the liquidity issue or how we manage the risk? So, you know, like at TIGR, we have really, I would say, very prudent margin policies. So we do have a team of, you know, risk managers to monitor, you know, clients' positions, especially during this volatile time. So to answer your question, there was no margin call or low any principal losses we have experienced so far. We will keep exercising our prudent strategies going forward, you know, to make sure, you know, with the volatile market backdrop, we're not going to suffer any losses in those spaces. And to answer your first question, the trading volume difference and commission, the blended commission. So at TIGR, like, we do have a lot of people trading futures and also a lot of people trading equities. So if you just lose the use the overall, you know, trading volume to calculate a blended commission, I think sometimes it's getting more volatile. It's not really a good, you know, indicative like commission of how we operate our business. So we give you the pure cash equity commissions, which means it's more stable. So the reason, you know, it increased from 5 bps in fourth quarter 2018 to 8 bps in fourth quarter 2019 is because in the U.S. we charge by shares. And in fourth quarter 2019, there are people trading more, you know, low dollar amount shares, which means, you know, even though the total value looks low, but actually there are more shares to be traded. So that's why our cash equity commission has gone up from 2018 fourth quarter.
那我来回答一下第三个问题。就像六年前这个开始创业做劳务证券，我们觉得这个赛道这个科技跟金融的结合其实才刚刚开始。那券商其实是一个很古老行业，那老虎为什么能在过去六年里面，包括刚刚介绍过去一年里面，我们能取得高速增长？我们依然认为这个整个传统的券商，包括一些其他的这个有商竞争对手，在这个领域里面，这个依然留下了大量的这样的空间。那券商竞争其实是一个全方位的这样的一个比较，从合规 到产品技术到获客到用户体验等很多方面。那简单讲讲，比如然后我们在这一侧我们拥有相对来说这个全球比较多的这样一个牌照，我们在美国、在澳大利亚、在新加坡、在新西兰，我们有相应的一些资质。那包括前面也介绍到了这个我们在2019年这个国际化已经提速，那2020年我们相信国际化会给我们带来更多的优质的这个相关客户。那这是我们在牌照布局上这个有这样的一个领先的优势。那包括传统其实很多券商一直以来这个没有拥有这样的一个自我清算的能力。那前面的战略发展里面也提到了我们这个从这个三方清算到自我清算，那我们相信我们在美股这一侧，这一侧也更加有壁垒，这一侧也更加复杂。那在这一侧我们的相关的这个研发投入，我们相关的这个人才积累，我们在自我清算上的这个进展，渐渐的会帮助我们树立起在美股这一侧更多的这个壁垒。那包括在这个用户体验，包括在这个用户能感知到的一些场景里面，比如说像这个美股打新，那过去的几年时间里面，其实我们做了非常多的这个互联网券商里面的这个美股的独家打新，比如说很火的像拼多多、像 Room， 那包括在过去年里面看到我们做了这个18单的这个中概股的这个美股 IPO， 其中承销其中12单，那这样的一些这个辅助型的业务也帮助我们这个给用户创造更多增量价值，让他能够以发行价参与到 IPO 中去。那包括这个也使得我们有了更多的这些这个选择我们的这个交易理由。那包括我们最近上线的像这个基金超市，像之前上线的这个闲钱管家，也使得那些不知道怎么来交易这个比如应该是要买什么样的这个股票这些这个有美元的人，他们可以找到自己多样化的一些这个资产的选择，而且这样的这个门槛更低，这样的这个资产选择比传统的这个其他的这个方案更加这个便捷，这个性价比更高。这是我这边的一些介绍，谢谢。
Okay, let me just quickly translate. So the landscape of brokers, brokerage business has been around for a long time. Same as the reason we started our business 6 years ago is we think there are a lot of areas we can improve, and there are a lot of optimization we can do. So compared to other internet brokers, especially those new startups, first of all, TIGR has a lot of licenses, for example, in the U.S., in Australia, Singapore, New Zealand. And it took a while, will take a while for those newcomers to get all relevant licenses and the knowledge and know-how how to run those broker-dealer business. So that's one differentiator we have. The second differentiator is most of those online brokers, especially China online brokers, they don't have a U.S. self-clearing license, and they cannot clear trades by themselves. That's the reason we acquired Moscow. We hope we can be able to self-clear in the U.S. Once we become self-clear, it can create a huge barrier of entry because, we are really, building the infrastructure of brokers, from bottom up. And this will take a long time and, for the newcomers to catch up. The third thing is on the product offering is what we want to do is now to, enhance user experience with a different type of product offering. So TIGR pioneered IPO subscription for Chinese ADRs. And, typically, retail investors, they most likely will get most allocation from TIGR. During the past years, we participated in those IPOs like PDD and Zoom, and also give us a competitive edge in terms of how we offer differentiated product to retail investors. And also, we have those fund modes and cash pods, those wealth management product. It's also a lot of way for us to try to have a comprehensive product offering to enhance user experience. So combine those three points together, I think, there will always be competition, but I think, these are the differentiated factors can set us apart.
Thanks, both.
Your next question comes from the line of Daphne Poon of Citi. Please ask your question.
Hi, management. Thanks for taking my question. So also three questions from my side. The first one is regarding the other revenue. So there's a big jump in the fourth quarter. I understand that part of that is because of the IPO subscription. But can you just help us break down like, how much is from different category, like how much is from the IPO underwriting related, and also how much is from the interest income on the bank deposits, and whether you see that strong other revenue would be sustainable going forward. And the second question is regarding the current rate cut cycles. Have you done any sensitivity analysis? Like what would be the impact on your earnings and whether that will affect the pricing on your margin loans as well? And the last question is about regarding the recent coronavirus situation. I'm actually wondering like, whether that has benefits you in terms of your new client growth and also your turnover, because we understand like from some of your peers and also from the onshore Chinese investors, the trading activity like, in the stock market actually pick up quite a bit during this like virus outbreak. So just want to get a sense of the trend you see in Q1. Thanks.
All right, thanks, Stephanie. So let me answer your question two first, then Tianhua will answer question three. And for number one, Tianhua and I will split, because I think that's two questions in actually in question number one. So in terms of the rate cuts, I think your question is how is that going to affect our business, right? So, you know, the rate cut on the liability side, because we don't have much debt or loan, so it doesn't help us to reduce any funding costs. But going forward, we are looking at opportunities to put on debt because right now, you know, if the liquidity is cheap, you know, as long as we can generate decent return spread on that, that's something we will consider. And the asset side, for the first quarter, I think it's still okay interest income. For the third, starting from second quarter, we will wait and see. Because right now, a lot of banks, they lower their interest rate to zero. And also our partners, our clearing brokers, partners, they also lower their interest rate to zero. So if you just look at the second quarter, it could have an impact on our interest generating income. But how big is that impact is yet to see because we just started the zero, you know, interest rate cycle. But still, we still have some bank partners offer interest rates above zero, so we will efficiently allocate our cash or our client asset to make sure we can generate returns out of the idle cash. To your first question, in the other revenue section, I would say IPO related is more than 80%, I would say 85% of the composition. The rest of the 10 to 15% is from interest income of the bank deposits. And I will let Tianhua answer your question, how sustainable is the other revenue, and also your third question about the coronavirus, how does that impact our trading volumes?
在同行业务这一侧，我们依然看到我们有这个庞大域里面这个有非常多得益于过去中国这个过去的五六年过去的十年时间有大量的这个创业公司进入到C轮进入到这个这种IPO这个阶段。那虽然由于短期的包括像疫情，包括像市场影响，这些公司可能会有这个IPO时间的一些推演，但是我们看到他们最终这个IPO这样的一些选择其实并没有这个本质的改变。那同时，老虎本身我们做一家这个金融科技公司，尤其是做一家科技公司，我们在过去的时间里面其实也采用了更多的在线的一些办法来帮助到这些企业进行相关的路演沟通，比如说我们安排了更多的这个在线的一些会议去跟这个海外投资者这个不管是NDR还是相关的这个上市的准备，这些也都能够这个发挥这些科技相关的这个价值。那市场波动这个
The other revenue very sustainable part first. So what Tianhua mentioned is still right now the pipeline is very strong. Even some of those like potential issuers delay their timetable due to the virus, but their intention to get listed is still very strong, and we are working with a lot of them to help them with preparation. Because we are a fintech company, so we do a lot of online NDR and roadshow for those guys to help them to manage their IPO timetable. So we think the pipeline is very strong, and we still think the business going forward can generate decent returns.
那我来回答一下最近这个市场波动对我们这个业务的一些这个情况的一些这个影响。那大家也都留意到了，这个最近一段时间，这个美国是非常大的这样波动。那总来说，对于经济业务其实有非常大的一个帮助，表现在几点。那第一点是，由于这样的一个非常大的这个波动，用户看到了更多的双向的这个交易机会，用户对于交易的这个参与度和热情非常高涨。那同时，传统来看，其实对于我们的这个客户群，或者对于总来说这个美股，对于华人来说还是一个非常小众的交易品种。但是这一次美股的这个暴涨暴跌，使得美股这样的一个小众的交易品种开始这个得到了媒体更多的关注，尤其是主流媒体的关注，它开始能够出这样的一个传统的这个圈子，这些也带来了更多的增量的用户，带来了很多传统这个不交易美股的人，所以这些对于我们这个增量的这个入金也有很大的这个帮助。那同时这个得益于我们在这一次这个品牌，那这些也都会使得我们在这一次里面这个收益颇多。
OK So just briefly recap, what Tianhua mentioned is that right now the coronavirus caused a lot of volatility in the market, especially in the U.S. market. So the volatility, first of all, give people, got more people interested and got their attention to invest in the U.S. market, and give people, the two-way, opportunities they can short and they can long. So given TIGR's reputation in this in U.S. market, it actually does help us to generate more accounts with deposits, and also help us to generate more customer, trading volume. So in short, it does help our, trading patterns and with our brokerage business.
Okay, that's very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you.
Your next question comes from the line of Han Pu of CICC. Please ask your question.
Hi, management. Thanks for taking my question. And first, congratulations on this strong quarter. I have two questions. First is about the fund more. Could you introduce more on the new business and what kind of ways would we plan to charge the investors as well as the fund companies? Maybe the possible fee rates compared to the peers. And the second one is about the customer acquisition. We have 11,000 new customers with deposit in the fourth quarter. And how many of them were from the mainland China and the other from overseas regions? Do we have any guidance on the customer acquisition in the coming year as well as the region allocation as we try to do more international business? And thanks.
那首先我介绍一下金超市。那金超市是我们在整个财务管理和资产管理这一侧这个非常重要的一个尝试。那过去其实老虎用户更多的是那些这个自己知道要去选择 A 公司还是 B 公司去做多或者做空的这些人，但是其实有非常多的华人，他们有美元，但是在传统的这个低息环境下，其实他们也不知道做什么样的投资，他们可能放在这个银行的这个活期里面，而传统的这个私行的这个门槛往往也过高，所以在这一侧其实是有比较大的这样的一个空间的。那我们这个 Fundable 的这个低息的产品是已经上线了这个30多只的金产品，底层有包括像 BlackRock 有汇丰等非常知名的一些 资产管理公司他们的一些债券型基金，他们的一些股票型基金，他们的一些货币型基金，来满足不同的用户这个风险偏好的需求。那未来我们还会不断的优化这样的一个产品，使得老虎从原来的这个主动交易者为主，变成这个主动交易者和这个被动交易者这个并重这样的局面，这也是我们这个非常重要的一个长期战略。那第二点，这个关于这个国际化这一侧，那在过去其实我们这个更多的用户是来自于这个大中华区，来自于这个中国大陆地区。那我们前面也提到了，这个国际化也是我们非常重要的一个用户增长策略。我们在美国，我们在这个新加坡，我们在这个未来在澳大利亚也即将展业。那我们预计在这个今年这个海外的这个用户这个增长至少会占到我们这个全部这个增量里面的这个10%以上。
Okay, so to answer your first question, Pohan, regarding the FOMO, so the rationale we are doing FOMO is that traditionally TIGR has a lot of customers, they like to trade by themselves, but we also have a lot of customers who don't really know what to buy. So we want to have FOMO, those mutual fund products on our platform to give people more choice, and we also diversify our product offering from active trading to passive trading so we can capture all the needs of our customers. So how we're going to make money is we're going to, you know, work with our partners on selling and also on fund administration fees. In terms of customer acquisition, so going forward, once our operation is fully on the ground in Singapore, U.S., Australia, we target to have on a quarterly, over a year, by end of this year, at least 10% of our new accounts that come from international, new clients. And also one thing to mention is we hope our ESOP also can account for about 20% of the new clients, on a yearly basis.
And may I have a follow-on question on the AUM of our Cash Plus product currently?
Mm-hmm. Right. Okay, so our Cash Plus, AUM right now is still relatively small. It's about $25 million USD at this moment. But recently it has been growing pretty decent because the 7 days return, given the volatility has been pretty attractive lately. That's one part managed by our in-house asset management team.
Got it. Thanks very much.
Your next question comes from Livy Liu from HSBC. Please ask your question.
Hi, just a follow-up question on the Cash Plus product. It's now the extremely low-rate environment. Are we seeing any margin pressure for this product? And also, just wondering the latest update of the Hong Kong license. What's the obstacles that we are facing for applying for that? Thanks.
So to answer your first question on the Cash Plus, we don't have any margin pressure because we, first of all, it's not levered. And also, we invest in very liquid products T-bills and other fixed income. So far, we don't have any margin pressure. And your question regarding the license, we don't really come on the license, but I think you can follow our release once we have something to publish.
There are no more further questions at this time. I would now like to hand the conference back to today's presenters. Please continue.
Hello, this is Clark. I would like to thank everyone for joining our call today. I am now closing the call on behalf of the management team here at Up Fintech. We do appreciate your participation in today's call. If you have any further questions or concerns, please reach out to our investor relations team. This concludes the call, and thank you very much for your time.
Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes our conference for today. Thank you for participating. You may now all disconnect.